All right, it is good to see you in the Lord's house this morning. I hope that you have had a blessed week. We know that God is good each moment of each day, and we just thank Him for the love that He shows to us, the blessings that He bestows upon us, the guidance that He gives us. We know that each moment of each day we need Him. We are definitely those sheep in need of a shepherd, and how blessed we are. I do want to remind you that we do meet on Sunday night, so hopefully see you here this evening, 6 o'clock. And then we are doing our prayer meeting on Wednesday night, and we have had some very wonderful times of prayer. And I hope that you may come and gather with us and just see God move in a strong and mighty way. We know that we should be a people of prayer, and so I hope that you are spending time bowed in His presence. And so you just remember all these things. I know Brother David has some announcements too. You come on and you pray for us for the day.
Yeah, I've got a ton of announcements. So we got a fundraiser next Saturday. So what we're doing is we're going to have a yard sale. If anybody wants to participate in the yard sale, it's like $10 for a spot. All that money will go towards our youth and children's fund. But if you want to donate all your earnings to the youth fund or children's fund, it's free. So just remember that. Just let me know if you want to get involved in that. But we are also having a car wash. If it's good weather, we're not going to wash cars if it's 40 degrees outside. But if it's good weather, we're having a car wash. That'd be donations only. And then we're having a hot dog sale. Hot dog plates are $5. Please let us know if you want to buy a plate. That kind of gives us a little heads up how many hot dogs to buy. So all that will be starting at 7 o'clock next Saturday. A car wash will start at 10. Hot dog sale start at 10 next Saturday. So y'all remember that? Awana tonight. Please learn your memory verse, kids, young people. Psalm 119, 105 is your memory verse. Also, we're having a special night. It's mismatch night. So if everyone... wear mismatched socks, mismatched shoes, whatever's mismatched. Just do that, and you'll get special points for that. On November the 1st, we cannot have like a huge fall festival this year. As you know, normally our fall festival is huge. Everybody in the community comes. We cannot do that this year, but we're going to have a small one for our kids in our church. And that will be November the 1st, actually during Awana. So we're going to have a trunk or treat, give out candy, have some games and stuff for the kids on November the 1st. So that'll be for kids. And if you want to invite friends, that's fine too. But we're just not broadcasting it out to the community like we normally do. But we do need candy. So if anybody wants to bring candy, just put it in the room right up front there. That'll help us out, keep us from having to buy so much candy for these kids. And also, there's a sign-up list. If you want to participate in the trunk or treat, some people decorate their cars up. Some people don't. It's up to you. It's more fun if you do decorate your cars. But as long as you bring your car, and we just want to have enough vehicles for the trunk or treat. We only have like 3 or 4 vehicles. It's kind of embarrassing, but we don't have a good number. If you don't want kids to get near you, you can just put candy in the bag and throw it at them. I don't care what you do. They just want your candy. They don't care how they get it. You can play ring their bucket, ring their bag, or whatever. But two more announcements. October the 17th, we're taking the youth up to Strawberry Hill for Cormaze, flashlight Cormaze. I've got flyers for that, so come and get one if you don't have one already, or I'll give it to you tonight during Awana. Then October the 24th, we're going to do something for the younger kids, like 5th grade and down. Normally, we take them to a pumpkin patch at Strawberry Hill. They're not doing that this year, just as everything else has changed because of the pandemic. But we are going to buy pumpkins for them so they can decorate their pumpkins here at church, and then we'll have games and food for them that night. So I'll have a flyer ready for that, ready for you next week. So I think that's all of them. Chris, you got anything? All right, we're good. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. We thank you and we praise you, Lord, for your wonderful grace, for your love, for your mercy, for salvation, for eternal life. Lord, I pray for Preacher Andy this morning, Lord, as he preaches. I pray just speak through him, speak through every song that's sung. Lord, I pray your Holy Spirit, Lord, will move up and down each aisle, touching hearts, convicting hearts. Lord, I pray that we'll see someone get saved this morning, God. I pray that we'll see someone get right with you this morning, God. I pray that we'll see our church draw up closer to you this morning. Thank you, Lord, for how good you are to us. We're blessed people, God, and we're so thankful. We do pray for this country, pray for the election coming up, pray for all the hatred. And there's so much hatred in this world, God. I pray that you'll get a hold of people's hearts, people's lives. Thank you, Lord, for preachers like Franklin Graham that had prayer walk yesterday, Lord, and thousands of people met and prayed. And we're so thankful for people like that, Lord. But help us to pray for our country. Give us a burden to pray for our country, pray for our police officers, pray for our soldiers. We need prayer, God, and I just pray that you lean on people's hearts to pray. Lord, send us revival, Lord. We need a spiritual awakening in this country. Lord, do a work as only you can. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, just one more thing. Who believes in prayer? Raise your hand if you believe in prayer. So Harry mentioned we're having a prayer service Wednesday night. If you believe in prayer, and if you're available, if you're not working, you need to come. You need to come. We sit down and we pray. If you believe in prayer, it's a good time for you to come and pray with us as a church.
All right, I did want to mention too, yesterday several of us were able to go to the Mill Village, and we passed out some hot dogs and went and visited some of the folks that were there. I had a good time. I appreciate Penny and Ronnie letting us use their yard, and what a blessing that was to be able to minister. I know we're in the midst of a pandemic, but God still opens up doors and gives us opportunities to reach out and to make a difference. So you just keep praying for our community, praying one for another. And then also do remember we are still taking up toilet paper for Connie Maxwell Children's Home. Now that will be on over in October, but I just want to remind you of that. And then, of course, we know that things are different, and we will take up our offering. We've got our four boys. They'll put their mask on, and then they will come through and take up our offering. And while we do that, we will be singing. And so if you'll stand, and if our wonderful group, the Parkers, will come, they're going to lead us in I Am Resolved. I Am Resolved. All righty, now we will have our children's offering. And so if we can have all of our children to come down, they want to take up our offering. You want to pray with them before? Take up your offering. Puts a smile on our face, just seeing their joy. We know that they just have so much energy, and as always, we want them to be a part of our service and part of our church. So you keep praying for all these young folks. Now we have another special treat. The Parkers are going to come and sing special for us this morning. Y'all pray for them as they sing.
I know back last year, I guess it was actually this year, earlier this year, small groups, discipleship. To be honest with you, at first I was sort of like, I question everything. Fired somebody. But when I studied it, I realized that it's a simple plan, right? It's, man, if we're not making disciples, that was the last thing Matthew wrote. Makes me make disciples. Everybody says, well, it's all kind of, we talk about podcasts, it's small groups, things you can listen to, you know, how to be a disciple. How do we do it? But to be honest with you, definition of being a disciple is in the invitation that Jesus gives to Peter and Andrew. It's right there. It's that simple. He said, follow me, I will make you. That's a disciple. Follow Jesus. We're going to try to sing about that this morning. Again, y'all pray for it.
I said, follow me, I'll make you worthy.
Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
Rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. John and James could never be the same after they heard him say, I'll make you fishers of men. Rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. Rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
Cast your nets aside and join the battle tide. He will be your guide to make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
Thus for the cross to gather in the lost. Oh, what a mighty cost to set us free from sin.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
All righty, what a wonderful song. Thank you so much. We know that Christ has called us to be those fishers of men. It's good to see Miss Marilyn. Y'all just keep praying for her. She's not feeling well, so she's going to have to leave. But y'all just keep praying for her. All righty, you turn to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16, if you would. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. We will end up in that verse. It'll be a little while before we get there. We will end up in Hebrews 4, verse 16. We know that there has been a burden, and I think it's been going on for some time, that God has been trying to get His people to spend time in His presence, to bow before Him, to call upon Him, and to take time to pray. And so this morning, just thinking about prayer, this morning, thinking about spending time in His presence. I think apparently many times we don't see the great need in prayer. I think there is a need, and many times we do not recognize that need. I know that even before all this pandemic started, God had worked up at Mud Creek Baptist Church, and they were working on getting a mighty prayer meeting going, and then the pandemic hit. And I think many of you are aware that yesterday Franklin Graham met in Washington, and they had a mighty prayer meeting there. And I just see evidence time after time of God trying to work, trying to get His people to pray. And whenever you think about Israel and you look back upon Israel's history, there were times that they would serve God, be faithful to Him, then they would drift and they would fall away. And once they drifted and fell away, we know that many times it took God putting great pressure upon them before they would humble themselves, surrender, and begin to call out to God once again. And my mind often goes back to when they were in bondage in Egypt. We know that they were slaves, they were in bondage, but God had applied that very strong pressure before Israel would really begin to truly call out to God. And I just wondered, my heart and my mind, what's it going to take for us? And after all that we've been through this year, after all our nation has went through, after all that our families have went through, feel that many people aren't praying. Many people are not taking time to bow before the Almighty, call out to the only one. He's the only one that can help us. I just wonder how much more God will have to put on us before the church in America truly surrenders, puts aside their entertainment mentality, their social club mentality, and begin to truly pray, begin to truly submit, truly surrender unto Him. I don't know. I don't know what it's going to take. But I'm hoping that before too long, that there will be a great number of people that truly, truly surrender. And my mind went back to David and Goliath. I remember that story, right? There in 1 Samuel, we know David and Goliath. That's something that we often hear even in Vacation Bible School. We know that the armies of Israel, and we know that those of the Philistines, they had put the battle in array. Army against army. The Philistine giant Goliath had come out and was challenging any in Israel to fight against him. And those that were a part of the army of Israel, those that were God's people, they saw that giant. There was fear in their heart. And they would not face that enemy. And then, little shepherd boy David, he comes on the scene. And this is what David asked. He said, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" Talk about some boldness. He had great faith in God. God had worked in his life in the past. He had great faith. His brother, of course, didn't like it. So after his brother had sort of verbally attacked him, David said, "What have I done?" He says, "Is there not a cause?" There's not a cause. All David was doing was asking questions. He had arrived on the scene. He had seen what was going on. And he had begun to ask questions. Why is this Philistine attacking the way that he's attacking, and God's people are just running in fear? Why are they not willing to stand for what is right, stand for what God had called them to do? So after that verbal attack, the message got back to Saul that David would fight this giant. And of course, even Saul doubted. So here was this little shepherd boy. Not only was he facing the giant, he'd already faced the doubts of his brother that should have stood with him. Now even the king, King Saul, doubting, saying, "Boy, you here, take all my armor." It was too much for him. So they were doubting him, questioning him. David's response, he says, "The Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion, out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine." He saw that giant. He did not let those that were doubting him to defer his faith in God. He said, "God had protected me in the past. He will protect me now. God had delivered me in the past. He will deliver me now. God had worked in my life in the past, and he will work in my life now. God was worth fighting for then. He's worth fighting for now. He was worth standing for then. He's worth standing for now." David was a man. He had faith. No doubt we need some faith. Goliath, he had his words to say. Brother doubted him. King doubted him. We know the giant just sort of mocked at him. "Boy, I'm going to grab you up and use you as a broom." He felt as though he could do what he wanted to with him. In verse 45, 6 and 7, he says to Goliath, Thou comest to me with a sword, with a spear, with a shield. David says, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts. You know, when we pray in his name, right? Here, David was going against Goliath in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. He says, this day, for the Lord delivered thee into mine hand. He says, I will smite thee, I will take thine head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air. You talk about confidence. Little David, he had some confidence. All those around were questioning, doubting. David's like, you think you something? You ain't nothing compared to my God. He said, I'm going to give you to the wild beasts of the earth, and all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. There was great purpose what David. David wasn't there trying to build himself up. He was not there trying to promote his own agenda. He wanted folks to know that the God he loved, the God that had worked in his life, could do the same for them. He wanted the folks to know that there is a God. There is one God. And we need to trust and follow him. It says, and all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear. It's for the battle is the Lord's. We give you in our hands. Because I think we forget that. This battle is the Lord's. This battle is the Lord's. David stood the power of God against the enemy. There is an enemy. There we look at all that's going on in our nation, all that's going on in our world. A wise Christian, a mature believer, what we're in desperate need of, will recognize that there is a spiritual battle that's raging. A spiritual battle. Too often we lower our eyes and all we see is just how we're affected by what's going on. We need to raise our eyes and begin to look beyond just our own little circumstance, look beyond our own little life and see that there are things going on many times that we can't even perceive with our own eyes. There's spiritual battle that's going on. The Bible says in Ephesians 6:12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. I think that phrase describes our nation. There's a lot of spiritual wickedness in high places. There was a time whenever sin was looked down upon, even as our nation, but now it's applauded. It wants to be multiplied. Do we truly recognize that we are in a spiritual battle? David, he went to fight, picked up some stones, and he had a sling. Don't you know, if you would have been in that crowd, if you'd have been a part of either army, and you saw this little shepherd boy going against the giant, and all he had in his hand was a sling and a couple of rocks, they'd been like, who is this idiot coming down to fight this giant? All those that had the swords and all those that had those military weapons would not stand against him. But here was this little boy, little David, slinging his hand. I can assure you there's folks out in this world that look at us and say they're a bunch of idiots. I don't care. My faith is in him. My faith is in him. They may not like the weapons of our warfare. God has given us weapons for this warfare. There in Ephesians 6, where I just read, he gives us the armor of God. He has enabled us to be able to stand in this battle, to fight in this battle. But then in verse 18, I think this one is often overlooked whenever you look at the armor of God. It says, praying always. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. We have what we need. We have what we need as believers to succeed, to go forth and make a difference. Unfortunately, most of our prayer closets are dusty. Very few knees are calloused. There was a time, I've read stories of great prayer warriors that would wear holes in the knees of their pants because they had spent so much time on their face before God. We don't do that anymore. We don't spend that time too busy, too selfish, lazy. See, we're going to have to get back to it. We're going to have to get back to a time for God's people spend time in His presence. In the midst of battle, in the midst of the fight, let me put it this way. If you go to battle in this day and time, you don't want a water pistol. That's not going to do much against the bunker buster bombs. It's not going to do much against the atom bomb. It's not going to do much. I think that's many times how we fight. The greatest weapons that He's given us is prayer. We just put it behind us. Don't take advantage of it. We go out and try to fight in our own strength, try to live in our own strength. I'm still learning about prayer. One thing that I've reminded myself of lately, I want to remind you of. No doubt, need to read the Bible. Learn what the Bible says about prayer. The best thing is just to pray. You want to learn how to pray? You pray. There's another tool that God has given us. There have been those in the past that have been mighty men and women of prayer. And it's good to look back upon those lives, to study those lives. I mentioned someone to you last week. I'm going to read just a few quotes. E.M. Bounds, he says, the prayer closet is the battlefield of the church. The prayer closet. It's central, the scene of heroic and unearthly conflicts. He also said, prayer is our most formidable weapon, but the one in which we are the least skilled. I think that's true. Prayer is one of our most formidable weapons. It's something that we very rarely use. J.C. Ryle, he says, prayer is the mightiest weapon that God has placed in our hands. Martin Luther said, prayer is a strong wall and a fortress of the church. It is a goodly Christian weapon. I'm hoping that we'll be reminded that there is a spiritual battle. And I'm hoping that somehow that our eyes will be opened and we'll begin to see how great a need that there is for this church, for us as God's people, to spend time praying, calling out to God. I don't think we see the need. And it scares me, to be honest with you. What is it going to take for God to get our attention? What is it going to take for God to grab our hearts and to get us to a place where we will stop and walk away from all that this world offers? Spend time in His presence. I don't think we're there yet. Do not think the church in America is there yet. David arrived on that scene, began to question. He said, is there not a cause? Is there not a cause for us this morning to spend time in prayer? COVID, U.S., according to what I read yesterday, a little over 200,000 people have died. I'm not getting political. That's what the number CDC's put out. A little over 200,000 died from COVID. Stopped our nation. It stopped our economy. It stopped the world. COVID. Planned Parenthood, according to the statistics of 2018, their annual report, they committed 40%. Planned Parenthood committed 40% of our nation's abortions. That's not even half of all the abortions that were committed in the United States in 2018. 345,600 72 kids aborted. That slow any economy? That stop any restaurant? All those kids murdered through abortion, and we just continue our life as normal? I don't know about you, but I think that's a cause for prayer. There's a cause for prayer. Planned Parenthood, listen, this makes me sick. They received $616.8 million tax dollars. They're not a cause to pray. They're not a cause to pray. According to the Christian Post, in 2019, around 42.4 million pregnancies ended in abortion worldwide. They're not a cause for us to take time out of our busy schedule, our all-important schedules, to pray. Every day, approximately 800 people in the United States are injured in a drunk driving accident. Not a cause for us to pray. There are 31 countries where gay marriage is legal. Homosexuality and all its crazy variances is exploding in the United States. Is there not a cause to pray? Is there not a need for us to pray? To beg God to work? When you think about divorce, child abuse, pornography, drug abuse, theft, murder, greed, it's everywhere. And we as believers just continue our little simple lives, going about making our own selves happy, not even willing to take time to pray. We can't sing that hymn anymore, Sweet Hour of Prayer. I dare to say that there's nobody here that spent an hour a day praying, separated, on your knees, in a closet. Is there not a cause to pray? Is there not a reason for us to spend time in prayer? When you think about all the sickness, all the disease, just cancer itself, is there not a cause for us to pray? Are we truly praying for those that are suffering? Are we taking time and lifting their name up to God? Today, according to ACN research, there's almost 300 million Christians around the world that live in a country where they suffer from some form of persecution. 300 million Christians. As of right now, we still have freedom. As of right now, we still have freedom. When was the last time you prayed for your brothers and sisters in countries that were being persecuted? Is there not a cause to pray? Americans who do not identify with any organized religion. I Googled what is the fastest growing religion in America. And there were some comments that talked about worldwide Islam. Fastest growing religion in the world. This is what I found on a couple of sites about America. Americans who do not identify with any organized religion. That's the fastest growing group in America. They say they're spiritual. They don't believe in anything in particular. That's the fastest growing group. They're not a cause to pray? Is there not a need to pray? Is there not a need for us to call out to God on behalf of our nation? I mean, how many people do you know that are lost? How many people are in your family that if they were to die now, they'd be separated from God throughout all eternity? How much time did you pray for them this week? How many do you know that are backslidden? I know we're in the midst of a pandemic. There are people that used to come to this church, no longer do. And it's not because of the pandemic. It's backslid. How often do you pray for them? How often do you lift their name up to God? I can tell you the answer will not be found in Washington, not be found in our court system, not be found in Hollywood. Just being honest, state of the church in America, the answer is not found in the church. Only hope we have is in Him. He's our only hope. The only hope for your lost family to get saved. The only hope for there to be cures. The only hope for there to be restoration. The only hope for there to be any change is God. Yet we're too busy to bow before Him. He's the only hope. Even after all that I've said, there's some that are here, some that are watching, that will listen to this, they still don't see no need of prayer. That's the condition of the heart church in America. It's described in Revelation, by the way, called being lukewarm. People that are lukewarm, you can go to their face, you can point your bony finger at them, tell them they're lukewarm, they need to change, you know what they do? Walk away and go have a Whopper. Be lukewarm. There is a need for prayer. Prayer is essential for the disciple. There is an enemy. There's a need because there is an enemy. There's a little book that I read, How to Pray by R.A. Torrey. A lot of this come from that book. I say it, I think it's important that we spend time looking at those that have went before us. Those that have spent time praying. Those that have spent time committed to being a person of prayer. And we can look into their life and we can gain to strengthen our own. R.A. Torrey is one of them. We know that there is an enemy. That there is a spiritual battle that's raging. He's attacking. Many times whenever we look at what's going on, all we see are the symptoms of the attack. All we see is the symptoms. We don't see the cause. There's a spiritual battle that's going on. That's the cause. Spiritual battle. There is a devil. He is active. The Bible tells us in 1 Peter 5:8 to be sober, to be vigilant. Can we even be described as that at all today? Is there anyone that's sober, anyone that's vigilant? Because there is an adversary. He's like a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. He's active. I want to remind us this morning, church, that yes, he is the devil, and he has caused much pain and agony and trouble throughout the history of mankind. He's nothing compared to my God. Whenever David stood before Goliath, he wasn't looking at how big Goliath was. He was looking at how big his God was. That's how we must face our enemy. We must realize that God is bigger than our problems. He's more mighty than those that come against us. James 4:7 says, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee. He's got a big old bark. But whenever we trust in God, there's no bite. He'll flee. I like that picture. I like that idea. Here's this big old bad devil, and he is mean. I mean, he's mean. Scares me to death. I don't want to tussle with him. Whenever I get on my knees, I begin to call out upon an almighty God. The devil will run. He will flee. He will flee. Not because of me, because of God I'm calling out to. Yes, there's an enemy. The devil, even our flesh. Bible says in Matthew 26:41, to watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. How are you going to keep from sinning? Bible here tells us prayer is a part of it. Be alert. Watch, spend time in prayer. Sometimes that we fall into sin, we fall into temptation, we give in to temptation simply because we have not spent time in His presence. You want to live a life that's pleasing to Him, you got to pray. The spirit indeed is willing. The flesh is weak. My flesh is weak. Your flesh is weak. Galatians 5:16, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. How are you going to walk in the Spirit? We'll not do that apart from prayer. The devil is an enemy. He's real. He's powerful. He can be overcome with prayer. The flesh, our most formidable enemy, always there, always coming against us. Through prayer, we can overcome. And then, of course, the world. The Bible tells us to love not the world nor the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, not of the Father, but it's of the world. The world passed away, the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Yes, this world is full of sin, it's full of temptation, full of evil. We don't have to give in to its ways. We don't have to follow its paths. There's paths of righteousness. Yes, there is an enemy. And we need to be people of prayer. I'm hoping that you see a need, that you feel a need, that you gain a burden for prayer. There is an enemy. It's also an example. If we look to the Scripture, we know that Jesus came to this world. He lived in this world. While He was here, He taught. While He was here, He preached. While He was here, He ministered. While He was here, He calmed the storms. While He was here, He healed the sick, gave sight to the blind. He was very active. We also know that there were the men that He was setting an example for. Those disciples that Jesus taught, those disciples that Jesus trained. If you want to know what a believer is to look like, you look to the disciples. Go back and look at those disciples, and you see what Jesus, who He wants us to be, what He wants us to be about. I don't know if you've ever thought about it or not, but those, and I know, kick out that 12th one, Judas, always a bad apple in the bunch, right? But you look at those disciples, Jesus Himself, the King of Kings, taught them, trained them, ministered to them, invested in their life. They went on. Those guys are crucial and important. Help us understand who we are to be, life that we are to live, example that we are to set. Those disciples and those early followers, they were people of prayer. They were people of prayer. God called those disciples, spent 3 years investing in them, setting that example. Acts 6:4, those disciples said, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer. Has that phrase ever come out of your mouth? Be honest. Never come out of my mouth. Says we will give ourselves continually to prayer, the ministry of the word. Paul, one that God used to give us much of the New Testament, devout man of prayer. Talk about the example. Romans 1:9, Ephesians 1:16, Colossians 1:9, 1 Thessalonians 3:10, 2 Timothy 1:3. Paul said, I pray without ceasing. Day and night I'm praying. Paul was a man of prayer. You will not be what God wants you to be apart from spending time in His Word. R.A. Torrey, he says, all the mighty men of God outside the Bible. Got those in the Bible as example. Got those that have went before us as an example. And there have been some mighty men of God through the years. Those that have taught and preached and shared and give their life. He says, all the mighty men of God outside the Bible have been men of prayer. That they've differed from each other in many things. But in prayer, they have been alike. That's true. You look back upon the history of the church, there have been some mighty movers and shakers. And they've had their differences. And they've had their own personalities. And they've been this and that. But every one of them have been mighty men of prayer. Jesus himself set the example. While he was here, he prayed. The Bible tells us in Mark 1:35, in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed to a solitary place, and he there prayed. In Luke 6:12, Jesus continued all night in prayer. He rose early, and he stayed up late praying. And this is Jesus. I know you've heard that before. If he prayed, certainly we need to pray. He came, he lived, he died, he arose, and he ascended. In our eyes, the work was done. In our thought, he's done all that he needs to do. And as far as salvation goes, he did. But, a couple other verses. Hebrews 7:25. Wherefore he is. Not was, not shall be. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing that he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Beautiful verse. It means Jesus is praying for me. Jesus, at this very moment, is interceding on my behalf. If I want to be like Jesus, I must be a person of prayer. He's still praying. Blows my mind. Romans 8:34, who is he that condemneth? Is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Whenever I was a kid, I was just a little boy, Lindale Baptist Church, never had too much confidence, had opportunity. They was having some kind of youth day, whatever. I don't even know what was going on. Can't remember. There's one thing I do remember. They had the old parsonage. And outside that parsonage was a little driveway, and there was a basketball goal that was set up. The pastor that was there at that time said, I don't even know what I was there for. I have no idea. I might have been 10 years old, 10 years old, whatever it was. I couldn't play basketball. Still can't. But I was out there playing, and he got the ball, and he started playing with me. And I know what he was doing now. He's trying to remember who I was. But he'd say, all right, Andy, let's go over here. All right, Andy, what do you think? All right, Andy, this. All right, Andy, that. All right, Andy. I mean, every other sentence he was saying my name. I was like, this guy knows who I am. He knows who I am. I mean, here I was just a little kid, and the pastor knew my name. He kept saying my name. This sort of made me feel good, 11-year-old boy. Nothing compares. King of kings, creator of all things, Jesus himself, calling out your name. He's calling out your name. He's praying, what are you going through right now? What's the burdens of your heart right now? Jesus is praying for you. Jesus is interceding on your behalf. About you, but that gives me great courage, great encouragement. I mean, I would be blessed if Brother Greg came and said, Pastor, I'm praying for you. I'd be blessed if someone said, I'm praying for you. And that's a great blessing, great encouragement. I remind you this morning that Jesus himself, he knows who you are, he knows where you're at, he knows your needs, and he is praying for you. Not only there's an enemy, there's an example in Jesus himself, the disciples, those that have gone before, There is an effect. I know you could preach a whole message just on this one point. Don't worry, I'm not going. The Bible says that you have not because you ask not. Have not because you ask not. How much do we truly spend in His presence? Neglect of prayer, major problem. There's no doubt in my mind it's the main reason why there's lack in our life. No doubt. Neglect of prayer. The Bible says in Philippians 4, 6 through 7, be careful for nothing. Right. You better turn off this mic, Nick. Green, turn off green. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. I'm not going to get into it. I mentioned this last week, and I'll mention it again. Hebrews 4:16. That's the verse I told you to turn to. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy, find grace to help in time of need. Is this a time of need? Yes. Do we recognize that? Many times we don't. But we are in a time of need. It says you want to obtain mercy? You want to obtain it. It's there. It's available. God says you can have, you can obtain mercy. You want to find grace? We was out on the Mill Village yesterday. One of the snore girls. Looked down. Found a dime. Is that one of the girls? I can't remember who it was. Found a dime. Grace, a whole lot better than a dime. You want to find some grace? Says it's available. Come boldly to the throne of grace. Openly, unashamedly, come boldly. And I'm going to read again what I read last time. Statement. Really been on my heart ever since I read it in that book. R.A. Torrey, speaking on Hebrews 4:16, the measure of our appropriation of grace is determined by the measure of our prayers. That's a powerful statement. Is there anybody here that wants more grace? Anybody here that wants more mercy? Answer. Spend time praying. I'm not talking about 5 minutes here and 5 minutes there. I'm talking about spending time praying. Jesus got up early and prayed. Stayed up late and he prayed. Daniel had a time set to pray. God's faithful through the years have had a commitment to prayer. Had a commitment to prayer. Charles Spurgeon. He says, prayer pulls the rope down below and the great bell rings above the ears of God. Some scarcely stir the bell, for they pray so lazily. Others give only an occasional jerk at the rope. But he who communicates with heaven is the man who grasps the rope boldly. And he pulls continually with all might. Is there anyone here this morning that's ringing the bells of heaven? You may pull it occasionally. I go by and tap the rope. I can tell you the state of America, state of our church, state of our homes, even the state of our own hearts. I hope we realize that there's a need for us to grab that rope, pull, and to pray. I ask you to stand. Girls, come. Now you have to turn the green mic back on, Nick. Bow before you. I just pray that you would put a tremendous burden upon our heart. Spend time in prayer. You'd help us to realize, recognize there's hope There's opportunity. There's a supply in your presence. May we spend time calling on your name. The most holy name we do.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Beside you, open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Beside you, open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Girls, I hope somehow the Lord stirred your heart this morning. You see a need to pray. All I can say, I do believe if we do not truly spend time praying, there will be no change. The nation will keep getting worse and worse. Folks will keep dying and going to hell. There's a chance. There's a chance for us to be a difference maker. Don't understand it. God works through prayer. I can't explain why God allowed me, sinful, fallen man, who had to call upon his name, him work. That's what he has ordained. That's the system he has ordained. I know I challenged our seniors last week. I'm going to do it again. Look back to Jesus as an example. look back to the disciples as an example. I asked you, all of our seniors, would you please set an example for my children? If you're a senior citizen, I ask you to set the example for my children. You'll spend time in prayer. This church in the past has had seniors that were prayer warriors. Do we still have it?